Hi everyone. I hope you're all enjoying yourself. I know I am. So I got promoted from a speed talk, so I hope this is all worth your while. There's a bit of pressure going on. So I'm presenting here as a bycatcher, I suppose. The two boys that have done most of the work on this deer work, I just lucked out and got to come to Sydney. So I'll get started. So we all know why we're here. We all know what the impacts of deer are. I'm not going to rehash that. I'm just going to showcase what we do in our tiny little patch of Australia and why we think that we're starting to get the recipe right. So anyone that went to Tracy's talk yesterday on Marama's, she made a big point of how big their properties are. Well, ours are teeny tiny. So Sunshine Coast is now allotted the ninth populated city in Australia. And we're also, in 2021, awarded the fastest growing population regionally in Australia. So when we talk about our blocks, they're really, really small, really, really urban. And the one of the main differences is that we can't do aerial. So I'll get started. So as you can see from the map above, every single blue dot on that map is a deer that has been taken out by our team and managed. So what the boys attribute their success to is a range of different things. So we have the support from our management, which is really important. So, So the process of our deer program. So a job can come in a matter of ways. So we can be really proactive. Our boys will go out there. We will relays with the community. We will try and actively sign up properties. We have customers come in and ask us for help because they're being impacted on. Or we have our partners. They reach out and they have had dealings with a customer that's getting impacted on. Regardless, we go out, we do a site assessment, we see if the property is suitable for control. We do up a risk assessment, all the boring stuff, but necessary stuff. Then we build partnerships, we get the job done. At the end of the day, deer get managed. So we know that numbers aren't everything, but we're kind of proud that we achieved this last year. So the numbers have been up and down. We know that with seasons, all that jazz, but we're pretty proud of this number. It's not the be-all, end-all, we know that, but we do monitoring as part of that as well. So thanks to Hamish with Avorda, we use his program as well. Most of our camera monitoring data goes through Avorda now, and you can see that it can spit out some pretty heat maps. These are restricted to where the camera locations are, so it is biased in that way. But we also got some really cool data out of it. So our boys have actually changed their management techniques based on Avorda data. So it spits out when the deer are most active during the day, during the night. So for an average day for our deer boys, they could be getting up at 2 in the morning and going out ground shooting. As part of this program, we also do thermal surveys. So that involves the two boys getting in the car with a cup of tea and some lollies, and they go out and do the same transects 3 times a year over a series of days. The numbers kind of speak for themselves. The more we control, the more the numbers go down, and they're staying down, which is a really good thing to see. So, road to success. So the boys contribute a few things. They're pretty modest when it comes to this. So my opinion from the outside is that their teamwork is what makes the dream work. So these two boys, they're professionals, they're good at what they do, they know how to do it, and they go out and they do it. Our management is a crucial part. So without our management support, without the money that we all talk about here, it wouldn't be a thing. So without the money, we wouldn't have the equipment. And they're not called the Deer Boys for no reason. They have expensive thermals that they go out with every night. We do invest a lot in their equipment, but they make it work for them as well. And not to not to say that the landholders aren't crucial as well. So the boys work really hard with working with their landholders, building up those partnerships, building up that trust. We heard just previously about poachers and the social licence. Without that social licence, without those partnerships with those landholders, without that land to work on, there's no program, there's no deer management, there's nothing. So we really prioritise that in this program. Partners, so we've got beautiful partners out there, the Lana Harriets of the world and the Matt Amoses. Without them, we wouldn't have some of the data that we have adapted our management programs today. So I can't stress heavily enough the teamwork. The teamwork that these boys put in together. So they butt heads, they fight with each other, they love each other. They spend probably, Mark says that he spends more time with Ben than he does with his wife. You make of that what you will, but they make it work. And together they provide the freedom to be able to do night work. They cohesively work together. One will be a spotter while one does the shooting. They just work well together, and not many people can say that when they spend more time than they do with their wives. They're very professional, they're very proactive, they get off their butts and they just get the job done, and we're pretty proud of them. They also know their animal ecology, so there's no point going out and trying to talk to landholders if you don't know your stuff. They know the animals, they know the species, they know the ecology, they know the breeding times, they know where the animals are going to be, when they're going to be there. They don't talk rubbish to landholders, they're genuine and they're hardworking. And that's what landholders look for. They don't want to be bullshitted to, they don't want to be lied to. They have enough worries to deal with poachers and people trying to come onto their land and force their way in. A lot of landholders are scared that you're going to lock up their land. They're scared that you're going to tell them what to do with their land. It takes a lot of work to build landholders' trust and keep that trust. And these guys do that well, and they know it because they know the animal ecology. They don't just take it for granted. They're always looking to learn something new, and that really shows in their work. So I touched on... Well, I might as well talk about this one now because I want to go back. So community education. So if anyone has been out with trying to convince landholders to let you on to manage deer on their property... this is generally the main concern. So the boys go out and they now have the ability to show them thermal pictures taken on their own property to show that they can tell the difference between a horse and a deer, a cow and a deer. For anyone that's never seen a beehive at nighttime, I thought it was pretty cool. Being able to have these tools and these techniques at our disposal to debut, you know, myths that the landholders have is just an incredible thing. Can I go back or not? No, it did. I feel like I'm missing a slide. So equipment. So I briefly touched on this. So the boys have thermal monoculars and then they have thermals on their rifles. So we've switched rifles. We've spent a lot of money on equipment. We've tried different things. We have, because we're so closely dense populated, we have a lot of urban areas. We get a lot of complaints about noise. I'm not sure about other states and that, but in Queensland, we are not allowed silencers. That's something that we have been fighting for a long time because of the noise factor. So we do what we can where we can. Again, we can't use helicopters, we can't use planes. We get enough complaints about the local airport, let alone sending up a helicopter to go shoot over someone's house. So this equipment has allowed for a lot of control to happen on the ground. So without the thermals, we would still be going around with spotlights. And as we just heard before in the earlier talk, you know, landholders see spotlights and they get scared. So that's something that we have been able to use and say that that's not what we do anymore. So you don't have to be worried that that's the management that we use. Touched on community support. And with that community support, this is the amount of participation that we have jumped to now. So by having a second officer come in 2015, we grew our participation base. The major thing that I think is when we had the second deer officer come in and change that officer. These two guys work so well together, and that second officer is just so good at his job in engaging that community and changing that mindset of his community and building that trust. He has almost doubled his landholder base in the space of 2 years that he's been in that role, which I think is pretty amazing. So I only have a short time left, so I'm going to skip to. So we have some limitations. I talked about silences, but the lack of public awareness is something that we are constantly fighting. So I don't think you guys have my updated slides on here, which is a shame because I have something about social license. We had an incident last week where we had a deer cross a major motorway, which was going to be a large piece of my conversation. So what happened with that is that we had a report come in on the dash cam footage from a local member of our community. We put out a social media, we got on top of it, we did a good news piece story warning our community to just be careful because we know the dangers of road strikes. The next morning, we had a road strike. And the amount of community support that we had and the actual knowledge that was out there from our community was really supportive. And without that social license, I just don't believe that we will be able to make the change that we need to, especially in peri-urban areas, which we have limitations. So thank you.
Thanks, Rita. Just stay here. There's at least a question for you. And it's about on-site burial, so for carcasses. Is this done on private properties or on a council site? How do you manage the carcasses? Thanks.
Yep, so it varies on private property. So if it's council land or all of the landholder wants the carcass gone, we put it in our specialised utes. We have winches in our utes to help the boys and we take it to the refuse dump. If the landholder actually wants to make use of it for their own consumption or whatever, we have grid maps that we give the landholder and they can go and collect that carcass. We don't make a profit off it. We're very careful about setting that tone. But yeah, the landholder is more than welcome to make use of it if they want to.
There's a couple more we've got quick. So there's a question about the funding source for your council. It looks like it's been going for a while and long-term support's obviously important for all stakeholders, including funders. So can you comment on where you get funding for this and what's driven that?
So we're really lucky in our local government that we have such good funding. As part of our rates, we have an environmental levy, which goes to fund a lot of different projects. I'm doing a talk later on that's also funded by that levy. It goes to fund certain specialised conservation projects, and that's where a lot of our stable funding comes from. We don't exactly put a bid in each year, but we put our case forward every 3 years for our prevention and control program, as we call it, and it just gets renewed and supported regularly. So we never really have to worry about it, which is good.